Ralph Waldo Emerson was born in 1803 and later went to Harvard University. His wife died from tuberculosis in 1831, and this led to him becoming a transcendentalist a year later. He met his good friend Henry David Thoreau when he was 32 years old, and later, in 1841, published in the first series of essays his masterpiece, Self-Reliance. This essay, later considered to be the definitive statement on individualism, was from multiple sources, including journal entries from 1832 to lectures between 1836 and 1839. He died in 1882, but his legacy lives on in the immortal words crafted in his essay, Self-Reliance. Individualism is a belief in the primary importance of the individual and in the virtues of self-reliance and personal independence. Emerson's beliefs in this idea is evident from the first line, Ne te quavieris extra, which roughly translates to, do not seek outside yourself. This is a recurring theme throughout the essay. To believe your own thought, to believe that what is true for you in your private heart is true for all men, that is genius. Speak your latent conviction, and it shall be the universal sense. This refers to the importance of expressing one's ideas and beliefs, and the value of expressing them honestly and personally. A similar idea that Emerson conveys is his concern for nonconformity. This is unmistakable in several passages, including, there is a time in every man's education when he arrives at the conviction that envy is ignorance, that imitation is suicide, that he must take himself for better, for worse, as his portion. The author is so adamant against conformity because he believes that acting as someone else only damages your inner psyche. Whoso would be a man must be a nonconformist. For nonconformity, the world whips you with its displeasure. The contemporary society condoned conformity, but like the transcendentalist he was, Ralph argued that part of not conforming and following the status quo was being misunderstood, a characteristic he held in high esteem. He expresses this concept when he says, Pythagoras was misunderstood, and Socrates, and Jesus, and Luther, and Copernicus, and Galileo, and Newton, and every pure and wise spirit that ever took flesh. To be great is to be misunderstood. Although he stresses the importance of self-reliance, he doesn't seem to regard a higher being as a separate entity. Rather, he regards prayer as a means of self-help. Prayer is the contemplation of the facts of life from the highest point of view. Supporting this notion, he also says, as soon as the man is at one with God, he will not beg. This seems to imply that the ultimate goal of self-reliance is to become at one with God. To put it another way, the central ambition of self-sufficiency is to reach a state of mental nirvana. Most, if not all, of his claims can be summarized in the statement, "Society everywhere is in conspiracy against the manhood of every one of its members." This quote aptly describes the purpose behind the entire essay. It inspires the populace to be themselves in a society that tries to push its members to absolute conventionality. Emerson also cleverly uses the key rhetorical elements of logos, pathos, and ethos to build his argument on the power of self-reliance. Logos, or logical argument, is used to support the idea that self-reliance leads to greatness. Trust thyself. Great men have always done so. And, with the exercise of self-trust, new powers shall appear. Pathos is used to manipulate the reader's emotions and help them see things from Emerson's point of view. Several attitudes are on display here. Welcome evermore to gods and men is the self-helping man. He cannot be happy and strong until he too lives with nature in the present above time. We are afraid of truth, afraid of fortune, afraid of death, afraid of each other.